This is a Sandler training audiobook, produced and distributed by Gildan Media, a division of Recorded Books, in partnership with Sandler Training. Selling to Homeowners the Sandler Way, a proven process for selling products and services to consumers in their home. By Kim Booker and Chip Doyle. Narrated by Sean Pratt. We hope you enjoy this program. Forward. Kim Booker and Chip Doyle bring a wealth of experience to the complex subject of selling effectively to homeowners and a pragmatic real-world approach that has delivered positive results in both the short and long term to sellers in a wide variety of industries. It's a pleasure to be part of their project and to introduce you to this book. When I first heard their idea for a book introducing the Sandler Selling System methodology to salespeople whose prospects are homeowners, I was excited for three reasons. First, I knew they each had an impressive record of successfully training such sales teams, on opposite sides of the country, no less, and I knew that each would include important personal experiences. Second, I had a feeling that their perspectives would complement each other well in a project of this kind. And third, I looked forward to their using this material to disprove a common myth about the Sandler principles, namely, that they are primarily, or exclusively relevant, only to business-to-business sales models. As Selling to Homeowners the Sandler Way proves in every chapter, the concepts and strategies our company's founder, David Sandler, laid out are relevant and career-changing for any open-minded salesperson tasked with selling anything to anyone. All that's required is a willingness to change your behaviors, your attitude, and your technique, and a desire to commit to a real-world learning process that's based on ongoing reinforcement and continuous improvement over time. Success is our mission, our promise, and our brand. It's the goal of our clients, current and future, global and local, on the street corner and in the boardroom. With this book, Kim Booker and Chip Doyle remind us that it's also the goal of our sales clients who connect with prospects in the living room and over the kitchen table. If you're one of those clients, I think you'll find what follows to be an invaluable refresher. If you sell to homeowners and you haven't yet worked with Sandler, we look forward to continuing the discussion with you. David H. Mattson, President and CEO, Sandler Training. Introduction. Why should you do something different? Why should you do something different? Maybe you shouldn't. Maybe your sales results are steady or even spectacular. Maybe the methods getting you leads and referrals are working well. Maybe your company's closing percentages are high because of a strong sales process. Maybe your competition is far behind and you don't feel the pressure to discount to close more business. Maybe you are happy with the money you're making, the type of customers you were serving, and the time and resources needed to acquire and keep those customers. Great. If so, you may not be looking for ways to improve. However, if you are like most sales professionals and business owners who sell primarily to customers in their homes, you may be tired of doing the same things over and over again and getting the same disappointing results. You may have a challenge in one or more of the areas we identified previously, or things might be going pretty well and your business is good, but you know there is an opportunity to increase your sales and get a larger share of the potential market. You are looking for ways to improve and become even more effective. In that case, this audiobook is for you. Some of the most common problems we at Sandler hear from professionals selling to customers in their homes are the following. 1. Frustration with overall sales results. 2. Concern about the length of sales cycles and the number of people who say, "I'll think it over." 3. Difficulty dealing with multiple decision-makers who have different expectations and decision-making styles, and who may not even be home at the same time. 4. Pressure from prospects for salespeople to send email quotes and follow-up, a process that results in playing voicemail tag or leaving perpetually unreturned calls and emails. 5. Pressure to discount in order to get business, resulting in reduced margins. 6. No good way to identify from a sales call who is most likely to buy and why. 7. Being increasingly busy with calls, quotes, follow-up, etc., but not closing enough business. 8. Frustration with hours spent on proposals to homeowners who don't buy from anyone, not even the competition. 9. Disappointment when sales that should close on the first call do not, and having no time for follow-up. 10. And if you're management, no consistent hiring or training process. Some salespeople get it, and some don't, with no real way to predict accurately who will be successful. If any of those problems resonate with you or your team, you might want to keep listening. In-home selling is different. If you or anyone in your company go into the home for any part of the sales process, this audiobook is for you. The techniques we'll be sharing apply especially to professionals offering products or services to customers in their homes. This kind of selling is different from selling business to business. In the unique world of in-home selling, you are not calling on a business where, since the decision makers are at work, they are expecting to make business and financial decisions. You're entering your customer's personal and private space where decision making can be a bit more fluid. Different rules apply in the home. Children and pets may reign supreme. All decision makers may not be there from 9 to 5, Monday through Friday. Often, homeowners have never before purchased your product or service. Or, if they have, they probably had a bad experience. Otherwise, why would they be calling you? In-home selling unfolds in an environment that can easily become an obstacle for the untrained sales professional. Have you ever had any of these things happen to you on a sales call? Jim, please excuse Spot. He doesn't bite most people. He may growl occasionally. Just ignore him while we walk through the house. My husband was planning to be here, but he got called in early. He said, just leave your quote on the counter. He has a couple more people coming by tomorrow. I have to run out in 15 minutes. Will it take longer than that? Or finally, wow, I never knew plants and shrubs could cost that much. If we decide to do this, it will cut into our family vacation. We'll have to think about it and get back to you. Let's be honest. Because you sell in this arena, you face a lot of unusual situations. You deal with personal space, personal relationships, and personal financial decisions. The good news, however, is this. You have been invited into their home. Most homeowners are too busy to shop around if they have no intention of buying. If you follow the right process, you have a much better chance of closing the sale than you would if you were calling on a business customer. You have an even stronger advantage when you learn the right process, set yourself apart, and allow the customer to buy. Our objective in this audiobook is to help you reach your goals by giving you the tools you need to become more effective. Why selling to homeowners the Sandler way is different. For more than 4 decades, Sandler has trained tens of thousands of sales professionals, managers, and business owners in industries that sell to customers in their homes. Sandler trainers, the two authors included, have gone on sales and service calls. We understand this unique selling environment. In this audiobook, we will introduce you to a complete sales process that is proven to succeed for in-home sales professionals. We'll also provide you with resource options to develop over time, since reinforcement and practice are keys to success with in-home selling. The strategies and techniques you will find here work across multiple industries, yours included. This audiobook can help you whether you are experienced or a rookie, whether your title has the word sales in it or not. If you keep an open mind and commit to practicing what we share with you, you can see strong improvement over time. We are emphasizing keeping an open mind and being willing to practice for a reason. Salespeople most frequently fail to see better results because they fail to do things differently. You didn't get your current sales habits overnight, and you won't change without time and energy. If you're willing to make some changes, though, we can show you a process that will improve your sales results. This audiobook is designed for those who sell directly to consumers in their homes, including, but not limited to, these industries. Custom home building, fencing and gates, financial planning, floor covering, garage door installation and repair, home repair, HVAC, insurance, interior design, landscaping, medical caregiving, movers, multi-level marketing, such as home-based business opportunities, outdoor living, painters, pest control, plumbing, real estate, remodeling, roofing, security systems, siding and insulation, solar panels, swimming pool construction and maintenance, and finally, window installation. Are you ready for better sales? Great! Let's start with a deeper understanding of why people buy and the purchasing system that most of your potential customers have learned. Chapter 1. Why Customers Buy. Mike, a floor covering professional, shows up right on time for his appointment in Mrs. Doyle's home. He makes small talk about the nice weather and the sweet little dog who is now licking the brand new samples he brought with him. He recalls that he is supposed to transition to the sales part of the call. "Tell me, where is the wood flooring you were looking to replace?" he asks. That's the only question Mike asks during this meeting. The homeowner shows Mike the area in the living room. Mike measures while Mrs. Doyle looks through samples. She says she wants to replace the flooring and will probably get other bids and look around a little bit before buying. Mike nods and says he talks to a lot of homeowners who say that. What she doesn't tell Mike is that she and her husband plan to put the house on the market in 4 weeks and either rent it out or sell it. Blissfully ignorant, Mike says, "You know, we have some great specials going on right now. No one can beat our price when you figure in the great service we provide." Mike proceeds to caution the homeowner about looking at other vendors. Most of them, he warns, have bad and unreliable installation crews. They may try to sell a lower quality product that won't last as long as the materials his company uses. They haven't been in business as long as his company has, and so on. She thanks him for the advice. They head to the kitchen table. Mike decides that since she says she is looking at other vendors, he had best give her 3 flooring options in case another company offers a lower quality product. "We call them good, better, and best," he says, showing off the samples. He presents various packages and pricing structures. Then he explains at some length how many years the company has been in business. The homeowner keeps nodding obediently. Mike pulls out his tablet computer and pulls up a presentation. The presentation explains how flooring is installed, the various differences in materials, and other important points. The homeowner asks Mike to send her an email explaining all the options so she can review everything with her husband. She tells Mike she appreciates all the options he has provided for her and how knowledgeable he is about flooring materials. She says they are just starting to look around and they will get back to him. Mike is optimistic. Mike feels pretty good about his visit. He gave it his best shot. The customer was friendly, and Mike gave her a lot of information about why she should buy from him over any competitor. At the end of a day of calls like this, Mike spends about 2 hours emailing quotes to people who have requested them. He attaches these quotes with care, after double-checking each one. Each has all the relevant part numbers, and of course, each has all the options he promised each person. He sends each of these emails with the same subject line, floor quote. The text of each message also is the same for each person. It reads, "It was great to meet with you today. Here is the quote for the new flooring. Let me know if you have any more questions. You can reach me at," and then he lists his phone number. The next day, Mike is busy with new calls, but none of them close on the spot. Mike's manager says he is not closing more sales because he doesn't follow up enough. It's hard to find the time with all the people he has quoted. He leaves many messages, but if the prospects call back at all, it's while he's on another appointment. He has so many prospects and so many new appointments, he's unsure how to prioritize. He does call Mrs. Doyle a couple of times, but he only gets voicemail and never a call back. He's disappointed because he thought she would talk to her husband and at least let him know if they received any other bids. Wait a minute. What do you think? Did she tell Mike she would get back to him that week? Did she say anything directly about buying from him? Nope. She was being polite. Politeness can sound like an agreement to buy, but it wasn't ever what Mrs. Doyle came out and said. Did she buy from another company the very same week in order to get her property ready for sale? Why, yes, she did. Who controls most sales calls? Prospects. Prospects have a system, but most salespeople do not. When we ask business owners, managers, and sales professionals, "What is your current selling system or process?" we usually get answers like this. "I go off what the customer says and take it from there." "I compliment their home, ask a couple of questions, and look at their current unit. Then I go over our brochure and talk about whatever product I recommend. They usually want me to email the quote, and they always have to talk it over as a couple. I either call them or they call me a few days later." Or finally, "I have been doing this job for quite a while. I can ask just a couple of questions and quickly figure out what product they are likely to need. I have all my brochures ready, and I write the estimate right then and there. I'm usually in and out in less than half an hour. If they don't buy right then, I am too busy to follow up, so I tell them to call me if they're interested. Then I move on to the next one." These answers may sound familiar to you. You may even find yourself asking, "What's the problem?" When you look at how often the opportunities in question close, however, the closing ratios tend to be significantly lower than what business owners and salespeople want. Remember, these prospects have let you into their home. They have taken the time and effort to prepare for a face-to-face meeting with you. You are right where the decisions are made. Unlike corporate selling, where there can be many decision-makers in many locations with lots going on behind the scenes, you have a big advantage. You have reached the inner sanctum. You should be closing at an aggressive rate, a rate that makes both you and your manager happy. Yet, without a consistent selling system, your sales calls may be similar to Mike's. Who was in charge of that exchange? Mrs. Doyle. Who gave her that control? Mike. The buyer-seller dance. This brings us to what we call the buyer-seller dance. Only one person leads that dance. It's either the salesperson or the prospect. It's never both. It may come as a surprise, but your prospects use a buying system. So do you, each time you encounter a salesperson you know wants to sell you something. You have played the buyer's role many times. When you encounter a salesperson like Mike, you employ some basic tools in order to protect yourself. You've had years of experience in using these tools, though you might not always be able to identify what they are in words. Mrs. Doyle might not have been able to describe exactly what she was doing to protect herself, but she was in control of the process from beginning to end. In fact, Mike's starting point should have been to have some sympathy for these protective strategies that buyers use. Buyers have been burned by salespeople so often in the past that they develop a kind of radar for people who make false promises and set unrealistic expectations. Getting angry or frustrated with buyers for using these systems will not help you close deals. You can learn how to deal with the most predictable buyer behaviors by deciding ahead of time what you will do in response. The buying systems that I'll be explaining apply to both prospects and buyers, that is, customers. By the way, we refer to everyone as a prospect until the person actually buys something. Sandler rule: there are no bad prospects, only bad salespeople. Your job is to figure out which prospects will buy and which will not. In order to do that, you must understand the buyer's system. The first step of the buyer's system: misleading. Unfortunately, homeowners don't always play straight with salespeople. They may tell you half the truth, or they may accidentally omit important details, as Mrs. Doyle did. Then again, they may lie to you outright. Hard to believe, we know, but apparently it does happen. Here are some of the most common ways buyers mislead. 1. We always get three bids. Prospect translation: if I say this, the salesperson surely will give me the best price and won't pressure me to buy now. The truth is, I don't have time to get any other bids. 2. We're just looking. Prospect translation: we need it installed by the end of the month, but I don't want any pressure to buy. 3. I make all the decisions on home repairs. Prospect translation: my spouse will need to weigh in on this, but I don't want the salesperson to finagle some way to get us to meet at the same time. 4. I will have to run this by my spouse. Prospect translation: my spouse doesn't care what I buy, but I'm saying that, so if I decide not to buy, I have that as an excuse. And finally, 5. We are basing our decision solely on price. Prospect translation: we buy lots of things because of convenience, value, and service, or because we don't have time to invite three companies into our home. You get the picture. That's the world you live in as a sales professional. That may sound harsh until you realize that you yourself have done this for most of your adult life at one time or another. Haven't you ever gotten a phone solicitation where you told the salesperson you were not interested before you even knew what the call was about? That's the real world. Saying that doesn't make you a bad person. It makes you a prospect. Prospects are especially guarded at the beginning of the sales process. If you've ever seen a prospect walk into a kitchen and bath showroom, you know it's quite common for the prospect to say, "We're just looking." You probably also know that homeowners don't generally take time off from work on a Tuesday afternoon to look at kitchen and bath fixtures to pass the time. Similarly, the homeowner calling to get a quote for lawn maintenance who says, "We're happy with our landscaper," probably isn't entirely happy. Along the same lines, the homeowner who says, "We will go with the lowest price," probably doesn't have time to secure multiple quotes. You've met these folks. We all have. On the other hand, not everything homeowners say is meant to mislead. The challenge for salespeople is to know the difference. It would be a lot easier to avoid being manipulated if you knew someone was going to lie to you all the time about everything. Instead, you have to remain constantly aware that information from prospects may or may not be valid. The misinformation prospects give you is a little like salt on a salad. They sprinkle in just enough to change the flavor and make it taste better to them. Don't be surprised when they do that. You would do it too in their place. It's your job to develop a detective's ability to sense when people are telling the truth and when they are distorting or omitting information. You might ask, "But why do they mislead me?" There is no one reason why prospects mislead or lie to salespeople. Rather, it's a lot of little reasons. For example, 1. Sometimes prospects mislead you to be polite. Suppose a friend's home had new furniture that you thought was gaudy and unattractive. If your friend asked you if you like his new furniture, how would you respond? It would take a very close friend to answer that question truthfully. Even a close friend might not tell the whole truth. The same applies to prospects. You may ask people whether they are interested in your product or service, and they cordially agree they are, in order to remain polite. There are a lot of polite people out there. 2. Sometimes prospects mislead you because they have had a bad experience before. Even though we here at Sandler work mostly with sales professionals, most of their business cards do not even have the word sales in their titles. Why don't they? Sales is the most vital position for a company's success. There is a saying, nothing happens until a sale is made. So why aren't people jumping out of their seats to volunteer that they work in sales? You know why. Some of the tactics used by salespeople over the years have given this great profession a mostly unfounded, tarnished reputation. Your prospects don't want to get manipulated by another salesperson like the one who burned me last time. Neither would you. And 3. Sometimes prospects mislead you because they think that if they don't, they will be maneuvered into something they don't want to do. Have you ever known those self-described great negotiators who repeat the phrase, "That's too high," even though it might be the most rock-bottom price they've ever seen? Somebody taught them that trick as a way of keeping salespeople off balance. Unfortunately, many sales professionals buy right into this. Their response is, "Okay, where do I need to be?" They begin discounting, even though price was never the issue. Many salespeople habitually play the submissive role because they've convinced themselves it will get them closer to a sale. But you don't have to play that role. At the end of the day, it doesn't matter why you can't assume prospects are always telling you the truth. What matters is that you lose a lot of time and waste a lot of energy when you do. The second step in the buyer's system: get information. Then there are the prospects who happily solicit your ideas, your solution for fixing their problems, and your pricing. Next thing you know, they pull one of these. A. Turn the job into a do-it-yourself project. B. Subcontract the job out to someone who is kind of in the same industry. And C. Use your work to give a head start to a competitor who did not offer the same comprehensive solution you did, but who ended up doing kind of the same thing you wanted to do at a lower price. This is another reality of today's world. Buyers have learned it's easy to get salespeople to give them everything they need. Many salespeople are taught that being asked for proposals...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.